Welcome to the State of the City, 2017. As a proud Northern Colorado community, Fort Collins is a leader in innovative ideas, businesses, and people. As a local government, the city is committed to providing quality services today while also planning and building for future generations who will call Fort Collins home. This forward thinking has helped Fort Collins become a leader in municipal sustainability and resource management, as well as to serve as a platform through which others can contribute their ideas and expertise. What really sets Fort Collins apart is a network of co-creators who are determined to build a more resilient future. As we grow into the community of tomorrow, the city of Fort Collins is shifting its strategy from one of simple innovation to one of active leadership to encourage innovation and collaboration throughout the community. Coming together in ways that support our economic, environmental, and social health will spur invention, provide resiliency, and enhance the quality of life for everyone. Join Mayor Wade Troxell and City Manager Darren Atterbury as they take a journey through Fort Collins to meet some of the great co-creators throughout our community. Their first stop is PFA Station 10 to peek in on what's new in fire protection, innovation, and collaboration.
Hey, Chief. Great to be here. So, you know, we're really talking about, you know, city as a platform and partnership. So tell me, how does PFA play a key role in city as a platform and developing partnerships?
The city's platform is incredibly important to PFA, and what we try to do at PFA is tag on to the city and the ideas the city has, such as climate action plan, that we are very intentional with the purchase of our fire apparatus and our vehicles, that we leave the smallest carbon footprint that we can. So we're connected to that platform very much, and it's a big part of your budget that you send to the PFA, so we feel we have to be very responsible for that and playing with that. So that partnership is there. Other partnerships that we've formed is through a contract with Puttarelli Hospital. They provide the ambulance service, and we're looking for ways to innovate and co-create with them as well in providing the highest level of emergency medical services we can. So we're looking for that opportunity to even co-create through other partners in the city as well.
Could you just talk about how citizens play a key role in our emergency services and safety and in support of PFA?
It's an app for citizen participation, and it's called Pulse Point. You download the Pulse Point app, all you gotta do is Google Pulse Point, you'll find the app, download it on your phone, and if you are near a cardiac arrest event somewhere that's in a public environment, not a private environment, it will summons you if you're within a quarter mile of that incident to where you can perform CPR. It will tell you where the nearest AED is, because frankly, if we want to save people from cardiac arrest, it takes the entire community. It takes citizen CPR. So reaching out to citizens in that way is huge.
You've led in a really spectacular way, and we're thankful for that. As we stand in this fire station, what are some examples that you'd like us to know about in terms of innovation?
Well, just one of the innovations that's right here in this station is our first is Engine 10, and Engine 10 was our first what we call Green Star engine, and it's a hybrid of sorts. But oftentimes when we go to medical emergencies or even fires where it's not the engine that's pumping, it'll sit in idle, and it will turn itself off and continue to run the electric systems off a battery system, and when it detects that the batteries are drawn down too much, it'll turn itself back on. It's how we can do our part to leave a little bit less of a carbon footprint, and it saves us a little bit of fuel as well. At the firefighter safety level, we're looking at innovations to where we'll have thermal imaging cameras in our face pieces, so when someone's looking for someone that could be trapped in a fire, they can see that image through thermal imaging, or they can find a hot spot, and it has a great deal to do with firefighter safety. Our board just approved a new radio plan where every firefighter will be equipped with the latest state-of-the-art radio technology where we have good identification of where people are on the fire ground. So innovation is very important to us on the technology side.
And the mayor and I get to speak on behalf of the community, right, and our organization and the council, and just thank you so much. You're an amazing leader. You're leading a phenomenal organization, and we're glad to have you as a partner.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks, guys.
Thanks,
Chief.
Thanks
for coming out.
You bet.
Now we head to Woodward to see what's new and exciting at their brand new world headquarters based right here in Fort Collins.
Thanks, Jennifer. appreciate you meeting with us. If you would, just talk briefly about why this facility and why Woodward and why Fort Collins?
This facility in particular is very important for us just to kind of continue our long-standing history in the city of Fort Collins and ensuring that our membership have a great place to live and work.
Fort Collins is an innovation community, and that's very much at the heart of what Woodward's does. Could you just describe innovation and Woodward and Fort Collins?
One of the reasons why we wanted to have our corporate headquarters here is to ensure that we had a really solid employment model. There's a talent and a skill set that people want to come here and they want to work here. We've been very fortunate at Woodward to be able to attract and retain truly top talent from the United States. And it's not just because of Woodward, it's because of the ties to this community. It's the opportunities that people have to work on creative products. It's the outdoor opportunities. It's the connection to the natural spaces that we have here on this campus. That's what makes this town great, and that's what makes the relationships that we all have here within the city of Fort Collins even better.
Jennifer, you've spoken to the long-standing relationship between Woodward and the city, and I want to say thank you for that, both the relationships in the past and as we look forward to the future. In any long-standing relationship, there are times where we struggle and we prevail through those struggles. Can you share your insights on some of those?
Yeah, well, you know, nothing the scale of this project is easy. You know, we had our goods and bads through the program. One of the things that I think that we did was we retained our open communication. We were able to voice our concerns, voice our frustrations, whether it was you to us or us to you. And, you know, there were areas where we struggled through getting to the right answer. And you know, ultimately, Woodward and the community benefited from that. We had a lot of really phenomenal success stories, specifically around Fort Collins Utilities. When we were originally doing this, knowing the energy demand that we were going to need for this facility, we had to go actively to the city of Fort Collins Utility, and we worked diligently on ensuring that not only that power supply was going to be available to us, but that the flexibility was there. So that's just one example of how that critical collaboration, when you decide to build something like we have done here in the city of Fort Collins.
Jennifer, thank you for being a wonderful community member and all of the Woodward members, important part of our community. Thank you.
Next, we head up to Northport to see what Andrew Schneider and the folks at Create Places are up to.
Andrew, it's great to be with you today. Why don't you just describe where we are and tell me what you're doing?
Sure. Well, thanks for coming up. You're in Create Places, where we have about 1,600 square feet up here at College and Pinion in the part of town we call North Fort. And you can find various neighborhood groups meeting in here. A lot of theater groups will come in and rehearse. And then, of course, there's a lot of art making and conversations about community. You know, in this area of town, we look a little bit different and our history is a little bit unique. So there's really an identity of the North Fort that I think most of the city doesn't really know. And it's really that we are a diverse community of people with fantastic and really interesting backgrounds. And the diversity up here it's one of the most diverse places in the city. So if you're somebody who values that, and I think everybody does, it's an exciting place to live.
So we are an innovation community, and what you're really speaking to is an innovation community in so many different kinds of dimensions.
Sure.
Why don't you just tell us about your perspective of where Fort Collins is as an innovation community?
Sure. You know, I recently got to travel to a conference, the National Consortium of Creative Placemakers, and in meeting people from communities all around the world, Australia, Canada, the U.S., and points in between, it became really obvious that the special thing here is our dedication to the triple bottom line. And I didn't expect it, but I actually wound up spending most of my time at the conference educating people around that and how a city can do that. So there's a great example of a community expressing their passion and the things that they care about, and then the infrastructure developing around them to support that. So that is the way that Fort Collins is fundamentally innovative, I believe, and it's what attracts people who can think outside the box and push for what is going to be next, what's going to take this community to the next step. So developing the city into a platform where you can access and there is, beyond transparency, just an invitation to come and co-create. To the extent that we can continue exploring that concept and defining that and living it, that'll help us continue our tradition of being an innovative city.
You've used the word platform. What about the idea of a city as a platform? What are your thoughts about that?
I think that there's, you know, in a sense, Fort Collins already is there, and the city is a rich platform for people who can navigate that system. And, you know, it's incumbent on us to make that equitable and inclusive for everyone so that the barriers that people have to navigating their city fall to the wayside and folks can just sort of, you know, get in the kitchen and cook. The added layer to that is that Fort Collins, by and large, people care so much about their friends and neighbors, and we approach this as a community of connected people, as opposed to just isolated folks who don't participate in their community.
Well, Andrew, you're doing so many exciting things and really making community and building community. And I've always felt that what makes Fort Collins such a special place are its people and everybody working together. And thank you very much for sharing your stories.
Well, thanks for coming up and spending some time in the North Fort.
Our next spot on the journey is to a brand new creative hub in our community, the Music District.
Well, hi, Aaron. It's a real pleasure to be with you today. We're in the Music District. Why don't you just tell us about where we are and things that are going on here?
Sure. We are a music-centric gathering place focused on the craft of music, the business of music, and really the community that surrounds music. We have rehearsal studios, practice rooms, beats lab. We really are a place where musicians and music-related businesses can come and connect and help solidify the music ecosystem, both here in Fort Collins, regionally, and abroad.
So just think about innovation mm-hmm. in our community, and we think about it in terms of oftentimes the tech companies
sure.
and incubators. And can you talk about how the Music District plays a role in our co-creation?
Really our goal, in addition to growing the music ecosystem, is to really connect community members, and people do connect over music. I think that innovation often happens when ideas come together and combine into something greater. And so the idea of the Music District is to be an actual physical place in the community where people can come and share those ideas.
One thing you reminded me of was bikes, beers, and bands.
Oh,
have you heard that?
I have heard.
What do you think about the combination of the three?
I'm down. No. it's very Fort Collins.
Yeah.
It's very Colorado, actually. You know, as far as innovation goes, some of the innovation with beer that's happening, is particularly here in Fort Collins, is really incredible. Brewers are constantly thinking of new, unique ways to brew and new ways to market their beer. So beer is an incredibly innovative industry. And then, of course, music, like I was saying earlier, music goes hand in hand with life. It's everybody's sidekick through whatever project or they're working on.
Well, Aaron, thank you so much. And we're glad that you're here. And we're really excited about the Music District being an integral part of our Fort Collins and our arts and culture, and just want to thank you for all you're doing.
Thanks so much for having me. Thanks.
Finally, as with many great local adventures, we finish at Odell Brewing, a long-standing community partner.
So, Wynn, thank you so much for meeting with us.
And certainly.
If you would, just talk about Odell's and being a part of community and what you've done here with the brewery and how you started and all that.
Sure. So we came to Fort Collins in 1989, Doug and I did, to start the brewery. And we ended up in Fort Collins because Doug's sister, our third founding partner, Corky, lived here. And she was on the planning board at the time. And she said, you know, this is an incredible community. There's all sorts of fun stuff going on. And by the way, it has a university here. So we thought, knowing very little about what we were going to be doing in our business, other than making beer, We thought it was a perfect match, and we showed up, and here we are. And we didn't anticipate nearly the growth we would have since coming here. And part of it I certainly attribute to having had the luck to open in Colorado, which is very beer forward. But otherwise, being in this community as it's grown and developed the identity it has been the perfect fit for us. And tying in with the local food movement that just dovetails perfectly with what goes on with craft beer has been really fortunate for us. So we've been having a great time here.
Could you just talk about community and how O'Dell's plays a key role in that?
It's very important to us, and I think without recognizing it, it was a fundamental value when we started the brewery that we knew that being a part of the community and giving back to the community was important to us. So we've done it in all sorts of philanthropic ways, but it's particularly satisfying to us that our facility itself has become a community gathering place. It's been quite nice for us.
You know, I think of the energy efficiency efforts that you've done. I think of water and think of just other aspects of the Lincoln Avenue corridor and things like that.
Sure.
There's all these aspects that are truly community and the partnership with the city and city services.
With that context, can you talk a little bit about collaboration? You to me are a genuine collaborator. I think it'd be worth hearing your thoughts about that.
Collaboration is such a positive thing. It's hard to imagine what people would not like about collaboration, except worrying about somehow that something gets taken away from them. But we've definitely found, and it's how we've been able to grow our business so successfully, is that the more minds you can bring to something, the better results you get. And if you bring very diverse perspectives in those minds, you get even a more powerful result. And it can be very messy in the process of getting to the result, but at the same time, if it's just me sitting behind my desk deciding what we need to do moving forward, we wouldn't be nearly where we are.
How does Fort Collins become sort of a launching point for all the kinds of activities that we see in this community?
You create a community that people want to live in, and the right people will come. You'll get creative people who are looking to try different things in the freedom of an environment where they'll feel accepted and respected and have lots of opportunities and lots of different touch points that they can reach out to inform how they're going to move forward. And I think that's how you do it. You just create the environment that's inviting to the people you want to have.
It's always been a great community, and I think the efforts that you've done only continue to make it a better community, and that's why we're so fortunate to live here. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
These are just a few of the great innovators and co-creators in our town, all of them doing their part to strengthen our community. Now, off to the Armory in Old Town to celebrate the state of our city with all of you.
You two have been busy.
Well, I like Darren in the Viking hat.
In the Viking hat, yeah. I noticed that like facial hair came and went all in one day filming.
So back to the state of the city address. It's all good.
Well, thanks again for being here, everybody. I just wanted to welcome everyone here and also say hello to those of us that are watching at our watch parties. We have two watch parties at the Lyric Cinema Cafe and at Prost Brewing. So hello, everybody there. And please join me in welcoming Mayor Wade Troxell and City Manager Darren Atterbury.
Thank you all, and thank you all for being out here today. And I want to say hi to everybody at the watch parties, and we're going to make our way there after we're done here. But really, it's a real honor for me to serve as your mayor. It's a wonderful community, and I get to see on a regular basis all the things throughout our community that make it such a wonderful place. I want to point out the council members that make up our city council, and they do a terrific job, and we've been working great together. Bob Overbeck from District 1, Ray Martinez from District 2, Gino Campana from District 3, Kristen Stevens from District 4, Ross Kniff from District 5, and Jerry Horek, District 6, and Mayor Pro Tem. So thank you all for being here tonight. And also I'd like to point out others that are here tonight, including, well, Jenny Arndt. She texted me right before that she wasn't able to make it. She's probably doing some good things down at the State House. I know she's introduced a couple of good bills for us, Fort Collins, former Mayor Arvid Bloom, Council Member Dave Edwards, Lauren Maxey, and Jamie Grimm, and then also James Thompson with the Senator Bennett's office. And just really appreciate you all being here. And if I've missed anybody, I apologize, but thank you all for being here tonight.
Great.
And also, I'd like to say that the city's executive leadership team is here as well. I think they're in the very back row. But without the partnership that I have with both the mayor and the council and the city's executive team, it would be hard to deliver world-class municipal services on a 24/7, 365 basis. So we've been looking forward to this conversation for a long time. So thank you for joining us this evening.
Okay, so I'd love to kick things off tonight by expanding on some of the themes from the video, and I want to start with innovation. How does a culture of innovation shape our community and the work of the city? And Mayor, we'll start with you.
Okay, well, just starting off, you know, about a year and a half ago, I was fortunate to open an exhibit at the Smithsonian that basically featured Fort Collins along with five other cities as a place of invention. And I think that's really indicative of a lot of things that go on here. And it really speaks to, and if you're the collaboration that people have with throughout our community. And I think that's a real differentiator for our community of working together. And with that, there's such a committed citizenry of our community, actively involved and passionate about so many things. And we hear about it on a regular basis at City Council. But it's really things throughout our community on a regular basis every day that really is making a difference.
Well, I think as we all talk about innovation, you know, it's very common to think about the big undiscovered item, you know, the big solution that's going to solve global problems. And I think what I appreciate about innovation in the city organization as well is that, as the mayor just said, sort of that day-to-day looking for new ways to deliver services better, more directly, more efficiently. So I think it's both. I think for us at the city, it's certainly big ideas. We're looking, scanning around the country and around the globe for ideas that might be a good fit for Fort Collins. But then the operational efficiencies, you know, innovation isn't just left for those big topics. It's how we do work 24/7, 365.
And I think the city plays a role in infrastructure that can help support that. Right now, the city council is involved in a discussion around broadband and looking at opportunities there. We have existing providers within our community, but we're also looking at, is that something that the city might participate in as a fifth utility and really providing broadband both at 10 gig speeds at uplink and downlink that can help support and create new businesses around that kind of technology for our future, and also serve our community in so many ways, healthcare and others, going forward.
You know, also, as we think about innovation, looking forward, in 2017, 2018, the council approved a planning process, which we've called City Plan. It's a 20-year window on where we're headed as a community. And I think, and we'll talk more about this in a little bit, but this city plan process is really an opportunity for city residents and others to really engage in the future of this community. Again, I don't want to take too much from the future conversation, but that's a 20 to 25 year plan. That's where we look at longer term sort of trends and innovation opportunities. You know, I think about that work, we're going to be looking at our master transportation plan. For anyone in the room that doesn't think that driverless vehicles aren't going to be a big part of our community 20 to 25 years out, I think you need to, you're a little bit behind. Mayor and some council members and I see Chris and Stevens, we were talking about this when we were in Pittsburgh, and Uber has a driverless cabs in the city of Pittsburgh where they're piloting it. So, there's been some changes and they're learning through that. But we need to be planning for that. We know that technology is evolving to the point where it's incredibly reliable. And if we're working on a 20 to 25 year, 50 year plan, to not account for that, we'd be foolish. So I think you're going to see some of those kinds of things folding into our day-to-day land use planning efforts, which I think is very exciting.
And just thinking about some of the infrastructure that we have, such as the MAX, Bus Rapid Transit, and thinking about that in partnership and doing some maybe point-to-point mass transit in partnership with
perhaps an Uber and that sort of thing, and also other infrastructure that we have. For example, the Northern Colorado Regional Airport, and we have the virtual air tower, and other possibilities, and then people at Colorado State University that are working in this area. So when we think about being a university city and partnerships and engagement in not only the modalities of transportation that serve us well today, but looking to the future and building in that direction.
So I have one final comment around innovation, and we're going to talk about a sense of place. And I think in this community, it's not uncommon that you hear your local government talk about creating a sense of place. If you think about Old Town Square, for example, downtown, there's a real sense of place there, that when you're there, you know you're in this really cool place that you want to hang out in, you want to be with friends, and you want to, in the past, as we've sort of researched this, and we've been involved in both topics of sense of place and in innovation, they've been seen as separate. So innovation, for example, in private industry, historically, in many cases, has been done on campuses, behind closed doors, lockdown environments. What we're seeing is a real trend that innovation occurs when there's a sense of place. So this idea of marrying a sense of place and innovation, and that's where I think, and you know, the mayor and I have talked about this a lot, that's where coffee shops and places that have been highlighted, really cool places where people want to go to this third place. There's home, there's work, and then a third place where they're with other like-minded people, and there's a dynamic going on there. I think that too, innovation thinking without a sense of place, without attention to that space, I think, again, we need to be really attentive to that. And I love the fact that the mayor and the council and our executive team are, I think, really equipped, well equipped for that conversation coming into our planning.
So let's dive into sense of place a little bit more since you mentioned it, Darren. So what do you think are some of the unique assets and also some of the challenges that contribute to Fort Collins' sense of place?
You know, being born and raised in Fort Collins and now serving as the mayor, you know, I remember when it was 20,000, now it's 160,000. And I think it's better in so many ways. And because of that, I think we've been able to maintain a sense of place. And so for me, a sense of place is really the values that people appreciate within your community. And it's very much, our efforts towards nature in the city, where you're only 10 minutes away from a natural setting, or it can be a vibrant, dynamic setting like the Music District is, that really creates music and thriving in the creative space, and also like creating places that Andrew talked about. But we have, you know, so many places that are starting to develop that really can energize people and engage people in our community that really allows for a sense of place to happen.
So, you know, I think before people really get this sense of belonging, there's some really basic needs that need to be met. One is, not only does there need to be a safe environment, but people need to perceive that it's safe. And, you know, as I'm thinking about this conversation we're about to have, one of the hard parts about State of the City address is I want to address so many of our operational 24/7, 365 services. I just have this, it's just the city manager in me. I want to talk about that, mayor, and we want to talk about future things, but also people aren't going to have a sense of place. They're not going to have a sense of belonging if they don't feel safe. And what's wonderful about police services and our partnership with a lot of other entities around Fort Collins and around the region is it's a very safe place. Fort Collins is one of the safest cities in all of North America. There are also some spots and some time of days where people don't perceive it to be safe. And so I know in talking with the chief and others, that's just as important of a concern. The numbers don't bear it out, but the perception of safety. So I think that's a fundamental issue. Another one that the mayor touched on is neighborhood livability. You know, I know that in this 2017-18 budget, the council adopted numerous measures that reinforce our existing quality, the quality of our existing neighborhoods. There's concern that those are, they're depleting while the community's growing. And I wish we had all night to talk about neighborhood quality, but I really appreciate the commitment to that. So as Fort Collins is building out, I think there's also a deep commitment to making sure that we don't lose ground on our existing wonderful neighborhoods.
Another item that we talk about regularly as a council is housing affordability and really supporting housing at various price points within our community that can support a workforce and a professional within our community and all, and so that we really do remain a viable, vibrant community. And with that, there are a number of things that council has worked on and continues to work on related to housing affordability, and including the construction defects law, and working with our state legislators on that, as well as working with supply and regulations and making so that we have a supply of affordable housing within our community. And also, it's so important because of our transportation systems, that sort of thing, to keep a viable community of neighborhoods within our town so that that can really support the broad aspect of what our community is.
You know, I think also when we're talking about this sense of place or community building, it's also this nuance between the built and the natural environment. And what I love about Fort Collins is that we seem to have that down pretty well. We've inherited this incredible environment, this ethic of environmental stewardship for decades. And whether it's air quality, whether it's the protecting the interface with the habitat, and this idea of nature in the city, which is really amazing. Our open space program has been phenomenal in preserving tens of thousands of acres, and both in critical foothills to plains environments, separating what we call community separators, separating the community so that we don't grow into Loveland and become a somewhere else, and so that I really love that about Fort Collins, that we're getting that right, but we also need to continue to pay more and more attention to that. And then just the quality of architecture matters as well. So if you think about the community now versus when the mayor was a young child, and then where this is my kids' hometown as well. So when they become parents and grandparents, the architecture needs to be significant also. And I think there needs to be more intentionality around that. And I'm looking forward to that being part of the plan, the city plan for Collins process.
Thank you. So we've also wanted to incorporate some hot topics that we hear on social media tonight. And the first one is a tough one, but very important, and clearly something that's top of mind for our community, and that's homelessness. So can you speak a little bit more about the challenge that this is for our community and other communities as well?
Sure. I think it partly builds on the previous discussion with affordable housing, and the city has a land bank and is investing in some lower income forms of housing from our land bank. But it actually this is a very hard issue, the homelessness issue within our community. It's very complex from the standpoint of there's some individuals within our community that are in a difficult situation. We're really talking about our point in time counts, where we're talking about 300 homelessness, and that might vary seasonally somewhat, but mix is made up of there's also transients in there. There's drug issues as well as alcohol issues as well as mental health issues, and so all those are kind of convolved together. And so the city has really undertaken a very broad approach in that, and really working with partners. Many nonprofits throughout our community, many from the faith-based community, addressing specific things as it relates to the homelessness. And this isn't unique to Fort Collins by any means, because it's towns up and down the Front Range and rural communities as well. And we're trying to address this in a Fort Collins sort of a way. And related to that, we're working together, we're solving this together. We're addressing it in terms of our downtown business community, and we're working towards a number of things. And I can't really thank enough the number of folks that work on this, including Homeward 2020 and Catholic Charities and the Murphy Center and so many others, Faith Family Hospitality. So this is something that the city can play a role as convener, as catalyst, but it's really working with many throughout our community to provide a full spectrum of services, but also consequences when the law is broken and really address that as well.
You know, the time that I've been in local government, I'm not sure I've experienced a more challenging issue. And what's difficult is as much time and resource that the city has invested in this issue and our partners invested in the issue, I think some people sort of scratch their heads and say, so what difference has it made? And I think it's made a tremendous difference, but it's really hard to see those results. It's hard to measure the results. We do know one thing that, and I can say this with 100% certainty, I do know that the city council is and the mayor are very committed to enforcing disruptive behaviors, illegal behaviors. And I remember, I think last year's State of the City address, we talked about this issue as well. And what we were talking about is really defining roles. And I feel very strongly that the city is not the only solution to this problem. And if we were the only solution and it were easy, we'd have it fixed. I mean, this community is very good about solving problems, and this one is not. I've not faced a more challenging issue in my entire career from a city government standpoint the partners and the work that our deputy city manager Jeff Mihalik, with the direction of the council in protecting our open spaces and recognizing the impact that some of these illegal behaviors have on downtown, we're working very hard, and it's a very sensitive topic, and there's very strong feelings on both sides of this issue. But I think, again, further clarifying the roles, the city is not going to be able to solve this on their own. I love things like Outreach for Collins, although there's a lot of questions about the effectiveness of that. We've got partners in this room that are helping fund that program, and the building relationships and trying to get people to services, and those are really hard to measure. But so for people who are maybe critical of that program, we do have a pilot period where we're studying it. We're going to do we're in the middle of it, so I don't believe that it's time to stop that mid-course, but when we run the course of that pilot program, we will evaluate it. We'll look and see how effective it was, and if it wasn't, then redeploy resources to look for more effective strategies.
Right, and I, as a city, we're committed to working towards solutions, and one thing, we have a big heart as a city. I know that people aren't outside on cold nights. We have mechanisms for emergency shelters and things like that. And that's where it's not the city, but it's through the partnership and working as a collaboration that it's realizing some benefits, but also working towards solutions in the future.
One other point I'd like to make is that, and we've talked about this in past State of the City addresses as well, and that's the restructuring of the city organization around this idea of sustainability, or what we call our triple bottom line. The triple bottom line is really the looking at the environmental health of our community, the economic and financial health of our city, and then also the social health of our city. Larger cities for 100 plus years, you think about large American cities, they have been working in this social health space since the growth of these cities. Medium and small American cities have not. We've relied on counties to provide social services and things like that, and to be attentive to mental health issues and more social services. So this is new work for us as well. What I'm really proud of is the structure that we built a few years ago, where we've reorganized major part of our organization around this triple bottom line. So I can't imagine dealing with some of the disruptive issues and some of the almost transient kinds of issues that this community is facing without that structure. So I think we're poised really well. We've got great leaders. I think we're getting crystal clear about the roles of each of those areas. But you can, you know, imagine a three-legged stool. And if the economic health of a community is failing, that stool is going to tip over. We believe also that if the social health of our community is lagging, that too is very high risk for our future.
So Darren, we'll just keep going on the triple bottom line. You segued me perfect into that. So talking about the other legs of the stool a little bit more, how does this principal factor play into our city services and the future of our community?
Well, I'll start off by saying the triple bottom line, as Darren pointed out, the economic, the environmental, and the social, that's the lens that we as council and the city organization looks at all decisions that we make. And we just went through our two-year budgeting process and approved that in November. And so the budgeting for outcomes. So we're really focused on the outcomes we're trying to achieve as a community. And through the lens of the triple bottom line, we can really evaluate things that really craft solutions that are really sensitive to the values that our community has. And so from that, it plays into our strategic planning process and our discussions. And I think what it does for us as a council, it allows us to focus on, you know, the policy level objectives that can realize the outcomes that we're trying to achieve. And I think we tend to avoid the small incremental sorts of things that really won't move the dial.
Yeah, we've talked, you know, a little bit about the social sustainability side. I want to just, again, in the context of the State of the City address, talk very briefly about the financial health of the city, because that's one of those triple bottom line legs. And I'm really, really proud to report that the city is in great financial standing. You know that several years ago we reported that the city got a Moody's rating service rating of AAA. That's in the 97th percentile as cities go. There's one other city in Colorado that has a AAA rating. It's no different than your own personal credit rating, and you know that's important. Our credit rating, as cities go, they look at, is our savings account appropriate? Not is it too large or too small, but is it an appropriate amount given this community's expectations of local government and risks like emergencies and disasters and things like that? They look at our cost projections and are we anticipating our costs effectively and well, and our spending, are we spending appropriately as we planned? And the answer is yes. The general city government couldn't be more highly rated, and that's really important. It's important to us as individuals, our own personal credit rating, but it's very, very important to cities as well. So I'm to Mike Beckstead and the council's finance committee, who oversees that very closely, and all of our colleagues, really, really appreciative of that work that's gotten us those results.
Well, and I think related to that very much so is we chart the cost of government. What does it cost our citizens to support our government? So you have your full discretionary income and what percentage of that. And we're at the bottom and getting lower in terms of the cost of government. So I believe we're delivering a high level of services to our citizens, but our costs, we're very sensitive to that. And related to that, I would like to talk about the Climate Action Plan, which the previous council approved a framework back in 2015. And this council has worked together on the road to 2020, which is making measurable choices to make an impact. And as we went through our 2-year budgeting process this past year, really addressing things that were in our budget, but in ways that were cost effective and had a rate of return. And so therefore, it was very much in context of a very responsible government. And with that, you know, I think we have an opportunity to continue being a leader as it relates to our road to 2020. I would also talk about an important part of our strategy there is that it's around the energy economy and really supporting industries and innovation in our community that can also can provide solutions for our community, but also solutions around the world. And that's where I think we can make an impact for our community, but also for communities around an economy that can support others around the United States and the world. So, you know, I think we're addressing this in a very responsible way.
Well, and I think the fact that 93% of our residents rated this as a great place to live says there's something, we're working well in this space. I think the final comment that I would have is that, you know, as I think about an important part of this triple bottom line is also the transparency of our local government. And so if any one of you want to go see how every single dollar was spent by your local government, you can go to fcgov.com and go to Open Book and see every single dollar that was spent and how it was spent. And the great news, too, is if you find some areas that you want to probe and ask about, you can. There's a way for you to ask those questions, and we'll be very responsive. Our customer service numbers, our citizen response numbers show that we're going to respond to you within an average of about 2.25 days with an answer. We'll respond to you very quickly, and maybe even within minutes of your request. But we'll have an answer to you on average within 2.25 days. And those are pretty remarkable results on the part of our team.
Okay, so my next question is another hot topic that we hear often on social media, and it's everyone's favorite topic, construction. There's a fair amount of it going on. So construction and traffic, can you talk about some of the projects that we have wrapping up and to look forward to as well?
You know, there's always a number of traffic projects going on, and we continue to have some. You know, last summer, one of the major projects was College Avenue repaving. And I don't know how many folks I would talk to about when is that going to be repaved. And once it was repaved, what a great improvement. And in fact, I think Darren has some data on how that, you know, from pothole perspective. But there's other on East Prospect, and we have some a number of projects going on that's really in partnership with Colorado State University through the intergovernment agreement that they're putting some underpasses, one at Prospect at Center and another one at Shields and Elizabeth. And those are great investments for our community, actually made by Colorado State University. And that's a great part of, I think, the story of a partnership of working together with those. We have a number of intersection projects, one that was completed, Shields and Drake, and another one that will be starting soon at College and Prospect, which is, you know, see 70,000 cars a day. So there's a number of projects, you know, in a lot of respect, you know, I think we're very fortunate as a community to have the support to invest in these sorts of things. And I would just like to point out the issue that was on the November ballot to retain funds as it related to Tabor. That was actually the third time we voted on that as a community. And we got an over 80% support for basically applying the Keep Fort Collins Great funds. It really applies to these capital construction projects.
So the city's 2-year budget, 2017-2018, which the council just finished and adopted, and it becomes your budget, is about a $1.2 billion 2-year budget. That funds all the services that you've come to rely on. That includes water and wastewater and electric, stormwater, police, parks, on and on and on. And of that budget, there's about $100 million committed to capital improvements over the 2-year period. So I guess the bad news is we're going to be building those projects over the next 2 years, and they're going to have an impact. When we're rebuilding a 85-year-old water line, it's hard, and it's in the middle of the street. It's hard to not have an impact on that. I will tell you that we're working very carefully to try and minimize the impact of things like lane closures. We've had some ideas around incentivizing and disincentivizing contractors to get in and get out quickly. We know that they have an impact, and let me just apologize for that. But it is the sign of a community that is developing, but what I really appreciate is the fact that there's, it reminds me of just the analogy of my own roof. If our roof shingle, if a shingle goes bad and we don't fix that shingle, we're going to be ending up replacing the entire roof and maybe even some substructure below that roof, and it's going to cost a lot more. And so a lot of the work that we're doing is to try and do preventative maintenance so that we don't have to come in and rebuild an entire facility, which takes much longer to do, and it's more costly, and it's much more disruptive to the community. I will tell you, because it's a tradition that we share the number of potholes that Larry Schneider and his team have filled in this past year. So in 2015, we filled 9,940 potholes. In 2016, we filled 6,011 potholes. And you might wonder why there's a change of about 3,000 potholes. Many of those are College Avenue, which I know most of you know that we essentially had a full-time person traveling up and down that corridor all year long, replacing those, trying to keep it so we don't have motorcycle crashes, we don't have, with the severe rutting and things like that. So two reasons why I would say. One is the 287 College Avenue improvement has had a dramatic impact on our pothole numbers. And the other one the mayor spoke to, and that's you approving a vote that allows the city, that sets aside a quarter cent to go in and do preventative street maintenance. And that is minimizing our number of potholes. So if we can go in and do crack seal or seal slurry kinds of improvements and surface level improvements and not replacing the roadway, that's saving a lot of money, and your tax dollars are stretching a lot further. So, and then the only other thing I want to say is that, first of all, traffic. We know that traffic and affordability of housing are the two most important issues to Fort Collins. Year after year when we do citizen surveys, and I think when council's out doing their listening sessions, they hear about those two things. One really good metric that I wanted to share is because of a partnership and a capital improvement on behalf of the railroad, the LeMay Riverside Crossing, you remember that awful, awful situation. The delay and the closures have dropped 72% because of both communications at the local level, you sharing with local elected officials, and then communicating through our legislative delegation in Washington, D.C. We got the railroads to the table. They made voluntarily made some changes, and I really, Mayor Pro Tem Horak is up here. The work that's going on around just the partnership with our legislative delegation in D.C., whether it's the I-25 work, whether it's train horn noise or train closures, those partnerships matter a ton. And without those partnerships at the federal and state level, I don't believe these we would have such dramatic results. So we appreciate those relationships.
And I'd just like to put a little perspective on our legacy in the past. City councils in the past have really done a lot, and one I'd like to point out tonight is related to our water. We have very senior rights along the Poudre. There's a trans basin canal that's called the Michigan Ditch that about 2 or 3 years ago it was beginning to fail. And if we lost that ditch, we would actually lose very senior water rights that are associated with being able to transport that water. And basically this past summer, really from when the snow stopped flying to when it started flying again in October, there was an incredible project that the water utilities, did in conjunction with a number of other partners that actually bored a tunnel that actually allows for the conveyance of this water to allow for our being able to maintain those water rights and be able to utilize it. So I think a point I'd like to make is really the history that we have, our legacy in this community has been always forward thinking, and a project that we completed this year that was an incredible project that was very successful, and that was the Michigan Ditch Project.
And that ditch, I had a chance to walk through that ditch as it was being built, and it it moves millions and millions of dollars worth of water. As the mayor said, these, you know, some of the pipes up there are wood lined pipes that are over 100 years old. And again, the vision that went into those facilities over 100 years ago, and the investment that was made on the part of long-term city water rights, that's part of that inheritance that we keep talking about is wow. And Owen Randall, our project manager up there with the contractors, that was quite a public works project, and it was on time and under budget.
Okay, so we're quickly running out of time. I'm going to have one last question for you. The two of you have been doing this for a really long time now. And how do you stay energized and inspired? And what's the community's role in co-creating solutions for the future?
You know, one of the things I think that keeps me energized is really I reflect a lot about leadership in the past and councils that have come before us and the decisions that they've made, and that we're realizing the benefits of those kinds of decisions. And just thinking about not the rearview mirror, but looking out the windshield to our future and the opportunities that we have within our community. And that's where, you know, the theme of tonight that we've been talking about innovation and as it relates to city as a platform to build the innovation on whatever it is. It can be technology, but it can also be in social services. It can be in helping your neighbor. It can be in the little thing that just makes our community better. All those are important parts to our community. And so it's things like that that I think we truly live in a special place. That doesn't mean we don't have our problems, we don't have our issues. But with that, I would take the passionate, totally bought-in citizenry that we have and a wonderful council that really works hard for the rest of our community, that it's a great community to serve as mayor.
Well, for me, I mean, I think there's two parts to the question. One is, how do you stay, you know, how do you stay focused or passionate? And then the other is the whole idea of, you know, for the community. You know, for me, I've having been here in this role too, I've had to recreate myself. My background is in city planning and civil engineering, and I've learned so much about civic engagement. I've learned what it's like to be part of a community that really believes in itself and aspires to something very different. And how do you help accomplish that? How do you help work with community leaders? And I'll say this, and whether the mayor's next to me and my council is all right here, people like Arvid and Lauren Maxey are here and other former elected officials. Fort Collins, you do a great job at picking great elected officials. We talk about the rearview mirror and we talk about moving forward. One of the things that we've inherited, what I feel like I've inherited, I inherited a history in that rearview mirror of great elected officials who had a big vision and who believed that if you focus on a big vision and you align resources to it, maybe it just might come true. And so for me, I didn't fully appreciate that when I came here, but it is what keeps me here. It keeps my heart going, you know, 1,000 miles a minute. I talk a lot with our city organization about what I call the it, the we, and the I. The it is does the it give you goosebumps? The work that you do you get goosebumps about it? What I love is Peter in our cemetery talks about the importance of his work and how it how it helps him reflect back to a really hard time in his life. So for me, I get goosebumps about the work. I have never, ever, I was telling a colleague the other day, had a boring day. I don't think I've ever had a boring hour in this city working with this community. The we is, do you genuinely love the people that you work with? In this community, the people that we get to work with, yes. I genuinely love working with the elected officials that we've had a chance to work with, and I'm very thankful for that. And then the last part is, are your individual needs in this role, and by the way, this is not just for me, this is for my 2,400 colleagues that we talk about this, are you able to accomplish certain things in your life that you wouldn't normally be able to accomplish if it were not for this job? So here's my theory. If the work gives you goosebumps, you genuinely love the people that you work with, and somehow you're accomplishing some of your own individual goals, it's probably the best place that you've ever worked. And if we can create an organizational culture like that, then we're going to keep the best, we're going to recruit and keep the best and brightest people here. And I think that's what we're doing.
You know, one of the things that we're about to embark on is the city plan, which is we go through a planning exercise about every 20 years. The one thing that's always set Fort Collins apart is we not only plan, but then we implement, execute the plan. And that's one of the reasons that Fort Collins is such a lovely place, is because it actually has planned neighborhoods and activity centers and roads seem to make sense and things like that. And so, you know, an important part as we engage everyone in our community is through the city plan is one way to get involved within the city. And actually, this city plan is going to also incorporate the transportation plan and the transit plan. And so that's a really big undertaking that will pull all those things together. And that's how each and every one of us can play a key role in our community through that planning process.
And finally, I would just say that this idea of the city as a platform and the idea of co-creators, for me, it's not that old paternalistic model that you give the city your problems and thank you very much, we'll fix them. And it's very, very different now. It's much more collaborative. And I think our civic engagement, our citizen engagement processes that have been developed and fully vetted and driven by the council, because we've missed it in some cases. But this idea of paying close attention to the quality of our existing neighborhoods, that's really co-creation. How do we engage those folks who've invested so much in this community? How do we not lose them and help them be part of creating? That, I think, is what makes this place very special compared to other places that I've certainly been. But it differentiates Fort Collins from most other cities, I believe.
And I would just point out, as the city moves forward and we engage everyone in our community in one way or another for a better community, I would state that the state of the city is strong and very bright. And so we look forward to the future and moving forward.
Thank you both. That's all the questions that I have for tonight. But before we turn it back over to the mayor and Darren for closing remarks, I just want to invite everyone to stick around. We're going to have some snacks, and we have council members and the mayor and Darren around. If you have questions, please mingle for a little while and continue the conversation. And then if you'd like to join us, we'll be popping over to the watch parties as well shortly. And I think that's it. So Darren, we'll start with you for closing remarks and finish with the mayor.
Yeah. Thanks everyone for coming. We really do look forward to having this conversation. We wish that it could be, 1,000 people up here having a conversation, but that's not how these work. I want to just say, as a final comment, how much I appreciate the contributions on a daily, hourly basis that my coworkers. I mentioned that the city's executive team is here. It takes about 2,400 of us to deliver these services on an hourly basis, and the professionalism and the competency and the caring is just unbelievable to me and really unprecedented. And we're getting really good at building systems to really be clear about the council's vision, aligning the resources to that vision, and then executing, and executing in a very intentional way. I think the most recent statement from Baldrige, Malcolm Baldrige Quality Program, recognizing Fort Collins as a best practice in Category 1, which is a leadership category. There are two Baldrige Award recipient companies in this room tonight, the CEOs from both of those companies, Kevin Unger and Jerry Agnes, and they've been incredible partners. But these lights would not go on without the folks that deliver these services. And you know what? They're also doing it in a very, very safe way. We don't want to send people to the hospital, and the intentionality of our organization to do that in a safe, a very engaged way, professional, all the things I said. I get to hear daily stories about how grateful you are, because people, and feel free, if any of you have compliments or areas you think we can improve, please send those to us, because we do listen to those. But when you have a compliment to share, I promise you those always get directly to the person with a note from me saying thank you. And the view that I have for these 2,400 people is remarkable. So to the executive team, your leadership, and to people, my coworkers who are watching this or gonna watch it, I'm so appreciative and thank you.
And Amanda and Darren, I'd like to thank you both for joining me up here tonight. And I'd like to, again, thank the council for working together. And I think you do a great job in serving our community. Thank you so much. And just want to thank everybody for coming out tonight, the Bohemian, the Lyric, and the Prost, where the watch parties are happening. And join us afterwards in either any of the three venues. We'll be there at some time or another. But I'd just like to add my thanks, and we look forward to a great year together. And with that, thank you very much.